Hello, everybody. Welcome to the next section of the Probabilistic Machine Learning Reading Group. Tonight, we're starting a new section of the book called Linear Models, and we'll be starting with linear discriminant analysis. Tonight's presenter will be Yaten Khurana. I hope I pronounced that correctly. And Yaten, if you want to go ahead and screw your sheen and start, go right ahead.
Sure. Thanks a lot. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Thanks a lot for introducing me. Yeah, let me give it a little. Let me first share my screen and then we can. Yeah, so I hope you all can see my screen.
Yes.
Yeah, sure. Thank you all. So here I'm Yaten Khurana. I'm from India. And it's, I think, night 10:30 almost here. So good. I can say good evening to all of you. And this is, I think, the first topic after the major introduction about the book, like decision theory, information theory, or probabilistic, like lots of theories about the probability. And this is the first chapter. We are moving towards the linear models. So I'm just about to give you the complete introduction and a brief about the topic of linear discriminant analysis. So in the between the session, if you have any doubt or any like clarification or any question, ask. You can stop me. You can ask in the chat, and I will be happy to reply in the answer. So, and as me, I have done the master degree from IIT Bombay. It's in India, Mumbai. I hope you all know about it. And after that, I have done some, as a AI researcher in Microsoft for 3 years. And after that, I'm currently working as a senior data scientist in Huawei. And my day-to-day work is just dealing with lots of data and machine learning. So let me come to the topic. Let me share my. So can I also open the video in between, if it's possible? Start video. If you can see me, yeah, that would be good. So let me start with the topic. So we are discussing linear discriminant analysis, and it's a kind of a classification approach. So in this whole chapter, I will be dealing with the classification approach with the given classes is C. And as we mentioned that linear discriminant analysis is not a discriminative model, it's basically generative models. So there are two kinds of models when we deal with the classification approach. The first kind of model is P Y given X. And in this kind of models, we generally learn directly P Y given X. And these kind of models are called discriminative models. And there are other type of models, basically, which we do, given a model P by given X, we first convert that into the Bayesian, using the Bayesian approach. So you can see the equation 9.1, P Y is equal to C given X, and theta are the parameters here. And we just applying the Bayes rule, P X given Y is equal to C theta, and P Y is equal to C. Okay, so and here the normalization constant in the below with all possible classes C dash. Okay, so in this, the first term, the P Y given C theta is the prior over class labels, and the term P X given Y C theta is called the class conditional density for a given class C. So the overall, this model is a generative classifier. And we are going to basically learn P X given Y C and P Y is equal to C. And where P Y is equal to C is a prior distribution of the class C, and P X given Y C is a class conditional. So it depends on what particular distribution we put for P X given Y is equal to C. And on the basis of that, we will define basically our linear discriminant analysis or our GDA also, like Gaussian discriminant analysis. So let me move forward now. So in the whole chapter, we will deal with this equation 9.1, and we will try to learn P X given Y is equal to C given the theta. Okay. So this is basically a generative model. If we learn that, given a class C, learning the X is a generative model. So let me move forward. So first approach is the Gaussian discriminant analysis. Why called the Gaussian discriminant analysis is because in this, the distribution P X given Y given C theta, we are assuming it's a normal distribution Given X, where the parameter of the Gauss multinomial Gaussian distribution is basically mu C and sigma C. When you see the mean of each class, like mu 1, mu 2, mu C, and sigma C is the covariance matrix of that particular thing, particular Gaussian distribution. Okay. So the corresponding class, so one more thing is PY is equal to C given X is called the posterior distribution. So posterior is basically nothing but the multiplication of the prior distribution, multiplication with class conditional density distribution. Okay. So once we have assumed that in the multivariate Gaussian, it's basically a multivariate Gaussian distribution, given a class C, our data is distributed in a Gaussian way. So now we can, I can write PY given CX theta is directly proportional to the pi C and normal distribution of X given the parameters. Now here pi C is the prior distribution of the class C. And I have done proportion here because I have, like, I don't need this normalization parameter. It's just direct proportional to that. And this why this particular thing is called this Gaussian discriminant analysis, because we are just assuming PX given theta is a Gaussian distribution. Okay. So coming to the next, now what they say is basically, now if you take the log of this posterior, so this is the posterior distribution PY equal to C given X comma theta, you just take a log of this, then you will get log P by C by C. Log pi c minus 1 upon 2 is just expansion of the multivariate Gaussian distribution, which is, if you go with the multivariate Gaussian distribution, so just be, I'm just introducing the first that in this whole chapter, we are going to be using the few the older concept that you have already studied, like a multivariate Gaussian or a categorical distribution of k dimension and or something like that. Then I'm assuming you all are aware of that. So I will not make like the justification for that. I'm just directly explaining those concepts. So a multivariate Gaussian distribution is the formula is basically 1 upon like root 2 pi power 1 by 2 sigma inverse and 1 upon 2 x minus mu transpose sigma inverse x minus mu. So if you take log of that, then you will you will get out of this particular term. And then is equal to log pi c if you take the log plus some constant, because we have converted the proportional to the equal to, then you will get some constant term here. And this function is called basically the discriminant function. And now the boundary, and this is basically the quadratic X. So any equation which is like X transpose AX, these kind of equations are quadratic X. So because of this term 1 upon 2 X minus mu transpose sigma C inverse X minus mu C, this term is quadratic X. That's why we also call it a quadratic discriminant analysis. Okay, let's look at an example here. So in the figure 9.1, so there are three classes. So first class is the blue color and green color and red color. So there are three classes. And we have just fitted the Gaussian distribution over each and every class, and red class, blue and green. Okay, and then what we did is, so this is basically the learning of PX given a particular class C. So this is what we learn Gaussian distribution at each class. And now in the figure 9.2a, we learned that this Gaussian discriminator, and we can easily see that this is a discriminant function, and we learned it. We can see that this is a quadratic in the figure 9.2.a. So the boundaries are quadratic in nature. So that's why this is called quadratic discriminant analysis. Okay. Even in the 9.2b, the boundary has become linear. I'll explain it, like why, how they did it in linear, like how this quadratic boundary has been converted into the linear. So that's the next thing that is called basically 9.2b is basically called the linear discriminant analysis. 9.2a is a quadratic discriminant analysis. Okay. So, yeah. So now I'm moving towards from quadratic boundary discriminant analysis to the linear discriminant analysis. So how we are going to convert this to linear? So now we are making a very strong assumption here that previously we fitted the Gaussian distribution to each and every class, and the covariance matrix was sigma C. Like for each class, it was different. And how you can compute it? Basically, you can compute it. You let's suppose you have 100 samples, and you have three classes. So you can basically, for each class, there are certain samples, and you can compute sigma C covariance matrix for each and every class. But now what they're saying is, if sigma C is equal to sigma, if you are making independent, you are making the covariance matrix independent of the class, then then what you can do is basically the above equation, you can simply replace the sigma C with sigma inverse, and the equation will become something like this. Like if you open it, then it will convert into this, and it will convert basically finally into the linear form. Okay, so the point here is that once we have got this equation, then this becomes linear in x. So this becomes linear, but we are making a strong assumption, and on the basis of that, we are saying that this is linear in x, and that particular thing is called linear discriminant analysis. And this is the boundary that the figure in the shrine 9.2b. This is basically the linear discriminant analysis. Okay, and you can see here there are certain points which may be like shifting now to the when we are moving from quadratic to linear, like few classes are not easily separate, like not as good separable as for the quadratic, but I think because it's easy to learn the linear discriminant analysis as compared to that, but we are not losing much. So that's why like it's the right assumptions to take this like converting each covariance matrix particular class to the generalized one. So this is the basic LDA approach. Now the next concept is that the linear decision boundary, whatever we have saying the linear discriminator, and what is the relationship between the LDA and Lochinger, and what is the connection between both of them. So the writer says that they are very much connected with each other, and they basically lead to the same form, and that they will do basically prove it via the mathematically. Okay, so p y is equal to c given x theta. This is the previous like equation that we want to learn, the posterior distribution, and this may be written as e to the power beta c x plus gamma c and summation over all the classes. This is nothing but the equation 9.7 is to be written something like this, because you can take the you can remove the log, take the e to the power, and you can divide it, summation over all possible C classes, and you can convert it into this easily. And you can basically write in terms of WC also, where the parameters may be converted into gamma C and beta C. Okay, so this is the equation form you can convert that into. Okay, and this they are basically showing y is equal to C. Now there are C classes, they are showing you can prove it, like the math becomes easier for the two classes, the binary classification problem. So if you go for the binary classification problem, if your y is 0, 1, and for y is equal to 1 given x theta, basically you can take e beta 1 to the power transpose x plus gamma 1 and divided by e beta 1 plus beta 0. And if you just basically do little calculation of math, you will get out of this term. And this is nothing but a sigmoid function, 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus x. And the whole function will convert into this form. Okay. And this is basically a sigmoid function where beta and epsilon is a sigmoid function. Okay. So now, what is gamma 0, gamma 1? So if you go to this equation, this gamma we have defined log pi c minus 1 upon 2 mu c transpose sigma mu c, and beta c we have defined sigma inverse mu c. Okay, so we are just computing gamma 1 minus gamma 0 here, which is nothing but you just take this part for each one and just subtract those. So if you take the subtraction with gamma 1 is basically for the class 1 level, and gamma 0, like pi 1 and pi 0 is basically for the class 0, and these two are basically the prior distribution of the class. Okay, so if you subtract these two terms, you will get out of this term. So these terms for gamma pi 0 and class 0, and this term for class 1, then I will get out of this term. Okay, now given this equation beta 1 minus beta 2 transpose x gamma 1 minus gamma 0, now we know what is gamma 1 minus gamma 0. Now, if you define this beta 1 minus beta 0 as W, so then beta 1 minus beta 0, and what is beta? Beta C for me? Beta C is nothing but sigma inverse mu C. So this basically sigma inverse mu 0 and sigma inverse mu 1, and this is nothing but sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 0 is a W. Okay. Now, what is X0 here? So X0 is a point which we need to define that it belongs to the class 0 or class 1. So if it belongs to class 0, then they have defined something like this, 1 upon 2 mu 1 plus mu 0 minus mu 1 minus 0 log pi 1 by 2 and this term. Why have defined this something like this is because then we have W transpose X0 is equal to minus gamma 1 0. Okay, because if you take the transpose of this sigma inverse mu 1 minus mu 0 transpose, and then you multiply that X0, then the simple equation, this equation will pop out. Because log pi 1 pi 0 and then this equation like minus two transpose and this equation will pop out. So this equation will become this, and hence this equation is nothing but sigma w transpose x minus x 0. Okay, so w transpose x 0 because this is equal to gamma 1 minus gamma 0. Okay, because w transpose x 0 is gamma 1 minus gamma 0. So I'm replacing def in equation 9.10. So in the equation 9.10, gamma 1 minus gamma 0 is replaced with w transpose x 0. And obviously beta 1 minus beta 0 is already w. So w transpose x plus it becomes minus w transpose x 0. Then the equation which becomes sigma w transpose x minus x 0. And in the same way, like this is same form as binary like logistic regression. So I'm not sure, like I think logistic regression is the next chapter. So I'm not sure like why, how they're comparing with that. Maybe in the older chapter they have to find that. So this is same as that. Hence the map decision rule is becomes like one if W transpose X is greater than C, where C is nothing but W transpose X zero only. Okay. And if you are saying that the probability, prior probability of both the class are same, then this CV will become W transpose X zero, where X zero is this. If pi one and pi zero is same, then log one will become zero and the equation will become one upon two W transpose mu one plus mu zero. So the threshold will simply simplifies to C is equal to one upon two W transpose mu one plus mu zero. Okay. So basically the whole idea is about that the binary logistic regression equation will pop it out when you will go about it. And how can you compute the threshold out of it? What you need to do is basically you need to take both the classes, like for binary classification, the class zero and class one, and for both the classes. And if you are saying that the probability of belonging to each the class is same as 0.5, then you can simply put the threshold. You can also compute the threshold C something one upon two W transpose mu one plus mu zero. Okay. But they also showed how you can interpret that geometrically. So if your sigma is basically a kind of identity matrix, is a proportional to the identity matrix sigma square I, in that case your W will become like sigma is mu one minus mu zero, and which is saying that your W direction is basically with indirectly saying that your direction of W is equal to the direction of the line joining mu one and mu zero, because mu one minus mu zero is a vector which is basically the line between mu one and mu zero. So your W direction is going to be same, and you can classify then each point by projecting into this mu one minus mu zero. That's what they have shown here, that in case of when sigma and sigma 2 are I, basically the for the two class classification problem, the covariance of the class 1 and the class 2 is equal to the identity matrix. In that case, your mu 0, basically mean of the class 1, mu 1, the mean of the class second class, and the line joining between them, you can take any point x and you can project that point into this line. So in this line, and you can compute the distance between W transpose X minus X zero. So, and the distance, basically whatever distance you are computing on the basis of this C threshold, you can compute whether this belongs to the class zero or the class one. Okay. So this is the one way we can basically create a connection between LDA and the logistic regression. So they are basically connected to each other. Yeah. So this is, we have seen like how we can connect, we learned that what is the decision boundaries for the Gaussian discriminant model and how it can convert it to the linear discriminant. But how we are going to learn it, how we are going to like do the model fitting in this case. And this basically is the next point, next thing I'm going to discuss, the model fitting. Okay, so in case of GDA, we basically, so the popular method for fitting, like learning anything, is like using the maximum MLE method, maximum likelihood estimation. So what you do in this case is you have to learn P, D given theta, and then you basically go capital N is the total number of points here. So N is equal to 1 to capital N, and then you basically get a multinomial distribution, pi N given pi, and a normal distribution of Xn given mu C and sigma C. So this is the distribution over all possible classes, C is equal to 1 to capital C. And this is assuming that all the classes are basically are independent, like Gaussian distribution of the classes are independent of each other, then only you can do this multiplication, C is equal to 1 to capital C. And all this assumption I think is not mentioned, but by looking at the equation, this is implied for. And then if you take a log of like log likelihood of the both equations, and then the multiplication will convert to the summation for all the data points, and introducing of the indicator function that if yn is equal to c, like it's basically saying compute, take the log of pi c only for those for a given c, for only for that particular data point, for this data point belongs the log pi c. And now basically for the each and every class, you just compute the for each data point, just take the log and take the distribution, the normal distribution of that particular data point of that class. Okay, so this is the equation which is popped out, and we can see now we need to find out, basically there are two distributions here. Like one thing was this M, okay, and the second was this normal distribution N. So we need to find out, we need to optimize for this pi, and we also need to find out the mu c and sigma z. They are the two parameters. So one is for class conditional distribution, and one thing is for basically for the prior distribution. So for the prior, we need to optimize for pi, and for class conditional distribution, we need to compute mu c and sigma c, and then how we will come up with the posterior distribution. Okay, so here the things comes out, and you have been studied in chapter 4.24, 4.26 that maximizing. So second part is the maximizing MLE of the normal distribution, multivariate normal distribution, and which is basically the mu c parameter is 1/NC, and xn, like you take the all the points which belong to the class C and average them out and divide by number of points which belong to this class. So this is how you can compute the mean of the estimated mean of class C. And the same way, like the sigma C, this comes with the MLE. If you apply MLE on any normal distribution, then the parameter, estimated parameter are this. And same with the covariance. Covariance of class C is nothing but xn minus mean of that class, divide that, subtract it from the data point, and xn minus mu c transpose, and divided by the number of data point belong to that class. So for the second term, we basically found out the parameters using the MLE. And for the first term, it's you can also optimize that. And this is basically a kind of a categorical distribution where the each yn can belong to c possible classes. And so you can think of it as a given y which can take up to 1 to c values, and this 1 to c values basically and now you need to predict a particular parameter which is basically the estimated pi c and the probability of belonging a particular point to the particular class. So pi c is nothing but nc divided by n, the number of data point to that class divided by n. So this is the MLE for this particular categorical distribution. So this is how we can compute basically the whole this distribution, like log the posterior distribution parameters. So now we have computed the posterior distribution, but now I'm telling you know that in this particular posterior, this is for GDA, like Gaussian discriminant analysis, and there are certain variants of that, like in which we have assumed that the covariance matrix is different for each and every class, like sigma c is different for each class here. Okay, now there is another version of this which is called tight covariance, where the same way we has assumed in the LDA that the covariance of each and every class is same as the overall covariance. So if we force this condition to be tight, then in case of then we will get the linear discriminant boundary that we have seen before. And now when you are estimating the parameters, then everything else will become same, like the mean of the, because we haven't touched the mean of each and every class is going to be same as mu c 1/NC summation over n by nc itself, but the variance will change. Now the variance is you have to basically do the average over all possible classes. So now the addition is c is equal to 1 to capital C divided by capital N. So because now this is the overall data point, and you have to go to each and every class, and you have to average it. So this is the change in basically the estimated parameter of the Gaussian distribution, and rest all is will remain same. If so, with that we will basically get the linear decision boundary. Okay. So next is diagonal covariance. So basically, even if in these particular cases, if you see how many parameters we had to predict. So mu c is basically the number of parameters are basically the depend upon the number of classes here. And we have to also predict the sigma c, which is basically here. If I say the capital D is the dimension of the input data, like D is the number of features, input features, then you have to basically predict D square features also here. So total features is like for every c, D is order of CD square. Okay. But if you basically, I take the covariance matrix as diagonal matrix, then the total number of parameter in the sigma c will reduce to capital D. So that's why saying like we can reduce the estimated parameters from OCD square to OCD if I take the covariance matrix. But the downside of this is that we are basically not able to capture the correlation among the different features. It's just the correlation like diagonal is going to be between x1 and x1. So this losses the ability to capture the correlation between the features. They also mentioned that. So this is the downside of it. But the advantage is that we can now learn a very, this approach can scale to very high dimensional data. So, yeah. Okay. So this is about the diagonal covariance. So the people says that this is a very strong assumptions that making the covariance matrix as a diagonal matrix. So another way we can do is basically we can perform a map estimation of the full covariance Gaussian matrix, and rather than using the MLE, and with that we can basically based on the result, like now again you maybe have studied like that using the like scatter matrix approaches and all and regularization. We basically computed the map of the covariance. It's nothing but you have to compute the MLE and like diagonal of lambda diagonal and 1 minus lambda diagonal of that. And lambda basically controls the regularization here. So this particular thing is called basically regularized discriminant analysis or RDA. So these are the different ways we are basically computing the distribution of sigma of the normal like Px given y equal to c theta. And in that also the first part is simple, like first part we just computed using the multi like categorical distribution, like multi noli or something categorical distribution. But the second part, which is basically normal distributed multivariate normal, in that we have made multiple variations, like first variation was like in normal like using GDA, and second we basically set for the linear discriminant analysis, and then because of the number of parameters are high we change this to diagonal covariance, and finally we did a map estimation basically of our sigma covariance matrix. Okay, so this is the all about this. So next thing is basically so now what we say is nearest centroid classifier. So if you have assumed that I have computed my post like class conditional probability, and which is right now we are assuming is a Gaussian multivariate Gaussian distributed. And once we compute that, then what we can do is we can assume our prior over classes as uniform. So if that thing is uniform, then what we can do is then what we can assign our label to a particular class C from which the distance is minimum. So basically what I'm doing here is argmin over C x minus mu c transpose like sigma inverse x minus mu c. This is nothing but a your Gaussian distribution multivariate, and all the constant has been removed because you are doing argmin over C, so not required. And you want just that C which this thing is to be minimized. So this type of approach they are calling is the nearest centroid classifier approach, and given the name short form is NCM. Okay. So but in that also, why to take only this particular distance metric as a probability distribution, multivariate normal distribution? We can even change that also in that, and we can define any distance metric like d square x mu c. And this is, I think, just a generalization they have given. And one way is given, you can define as basically x minus mu c is a second norm over w to this distance matrix. Okay. So how you are going to compute all this is basically major things there. How to learn the distance matrix is given in the future section of this book, but it's this. But the major part I want to highlight is this: you can also basically, if you assume that your uniform is prior, like uniform distribution, you are assuming over your prior over the classes. Okay. So right till now, we have learned the class conditional distribution and the prior distribution. And prior distribution is the categorical distribution or the basically the uniform distribution. So the next thing is, and the next thing that I is the Fisher linear discriminant analysis, and this is a very important topic in this whole talk, because this is so linear discriminant analysis is generally basically used when in case of multivariate multi-class classification problem, because if you go for the logistic regression for multi-class, then you have to learn multiple classifier using one versus all approach, like one class versus all. And but you do not have to do the same with linear discriminant analysis. And another important application of LDA is the dimensionality reduction. So you can also use this LDA for dimensionality reduction, even if the PCA is one of the other approach for dimensionality reduction. But LDA also gives a linear discriminant analysis. It also gives the dimension by keeping in mind the class labels in picture. So that's the advantage of linear discriminant analysis over the PCA that we will see in a few minutes, that how it can basically reduce the dimension of the whole data, even, and also keep in mind that the data need to be classified in a proper way for all the classes. Okay, so that is where the Fisher linear discriminant comes the picture. So let's suppose we have a data features x, which is the dimension r to the power d, and we want it to the lower dimension, and the lower dimensions is k, so k is going to be less than d. And this simplest approach is like we want to learn a matrix w, and z is equal to wx, where w is a k cross d matrix, and we need to learn this w. So PCA is one of the approach, but we already told you PCA can unsupervisedly, that does not take class level into account. Okay, so how the FLDA do is basically, so it basically find out this find the matrix W such that the lower dimension can be classified as well, possibly we use as a Gaussian class conditional density model. So that's the main approach the FDA uses. In the lower dimensional, data should be classified as well as the possible, and it's also be possible using a Gaussian class conditional density model. So this is the 2 points that the FDA uses. Okay. And another point is basically this is a restriction of the FLDA. I'll tell you how this restriction come out. This will come out of the matrix, that the number of dimensions which you can reduce this to k, that should be less than c minus 1, where c is the number of classes in the whole data sets. So k should be less than equal to c minus 1 here. That is a restriction of FLDA, so which define the limitations. So the whole point is in the FLDA, you need to find this W, and you need to find that particular direction. The same is in the PCA. Like you have to find the dimension where you need to project your data in that particular dimension, and then over that you need to find the, basically you need to do the further processing. Here we need to classify those data points further. So the derivation of the FLDA basically leads towards how we are going to find the optimal direction W. Okay, given the set of classes, like C classes, and the data points belong to the C classes, and we have to do to find the direction W on which we will project our data points, so that the classification will be also be good, as well as it also uses the Gaussian, as a class conditional distribution. So here they are giving an example of the two class classification problem, where you have two basically classes, one and two, and the mean of the mu one is given by 1 upon n1 xn, and mu two is given by xn, and 1 upon n2 like summation over 2 xn. This comes with the MLE approach. Okay. Now, because we basically want to transform all the means to a particular direction, which is W. So now MK is defined as W transpose UK. Okay. So all the means we basically has been transferred to this MK using the direction W, and also all the data points, or also all the data points of X1, like the first distribution and the second, will also be getting projected onto this W line. So here also Z n is also equal to W transpose. So now what we how we define the variance? Variance is basically simple, like whatever data point has been transferred to this Zn minus mk square, it's the variance of the data points after projection, and our goal is just to find this W, okay, and which basically will maximize the distance between the mean, because what we want is we want to classify those level as far as possible. Like if we want to increase the confidence whether the data point belongs to the class 0 or class 1, while we also want that the projected cluster should be tight. Basically, all the data points should basically minimize the variance. Like they should lie in a dense cluster. So we can do that by minimizing their variance. So the objective function will become JW is equal to M2 minus M1 square divided by S1 square plus S2 square. So where S1 is a variance with respect to class 1 and class like class 2, and M2 and M2 are the mean, like projected mean of class 1 and class 2. So the whole problem lies now is lying in learning the vector W so that this equation would be maximized. Okay. I hope there should be no doubt yet. So please let me know if there is any doubt, and so I can proceed.
Yeah, sure, we are with you.
Yeah, so far it's clear.
Okay, sure. Thanks a lot. So basically now if you are writing this side in terms of W, so it's in the matrix form. So this equation is now had been written in the matrix form. So JW is equal to W transpose SBW and W transpose SB, SWW, where SB is equal to mu2 minus mu1 and mu2 minus mu1 transpose. And SW is within class scatter matrix. So which is basically xn minus mu1 transpose, and for the class 1, and this is basically for the class 2. So this is the equation. And now you will see that, so there is a top, like the denominator and nominator. So I'll take them separately. So W transpose SBW is nothing, W transpose, and SB is mu2 minus mu1 transpose W, and which is nothing but this top part was what? M2 minus M1 whole square. This is nothing but M2 minus M1 and M2 minus M1. And the below part was W transpose SWW is nothing. It's the summation of the two terms, like for class 1 and class 2, and which is nothing basically J, like it's a Zn minus M1 square and Zn minus M2 square. It's just the defining the two. Now this is have given, so there is only one problem in the exercise of this particular chapter, and that is you have to maximize this ZW, and you have to basically differentiate with respect to W, and you have to equate it to 0, and then you have to find out for what value of W this equations basically is maximized. So if you will do that, then one can show that ZW is maximized when SBW is equal to lambda SWW. So if you differentiate it with respect to W, equate to 0, then you will end up with this kind of equation. Okay, where lambda is W transpose SVW and W transpose SVW. So, and you can do this exercise even, like take this as a challenge exercise. And equation 9.6 can be like a generalized eigenvalue problem. So if I can do something like this, if I multiply both sides by SW inverse, and I'm assuming here SW is invertible, then this equation can be converted into SW inverse SBW lambda W. And this is a normal, our eigenvalue problem. AX is equal to lambda X, where the we have to learn basically the eigenvalues lambda and eigenvector X, okay? So which means that the eigen vector of this SW inverse SB will be my solution for this W, like the direction W, okay? But they say that like this is where ideally I should stop, because now you should solve it, like you compute SW inverse SB, and you already know what is SW for you, you already know what is SB for you, you multiply and take inverse and compute the eigenvector, and that would be going to be your like directions for this. But and lambda you can compute using this W SB using that, and that would be the direction W where we have to project your data so that the classification would be good. But again, they said in case of two class classification, there is a simple solution, especially for two class classification problem, that SBW is mu2 minus mu1, mu2 transpose W, and mu2 minus mu1, and then the M2 minus M1, you can write it like that. So because M2 minus M1 is nothing but SBW is coming from the W is same, and SB is nothing but a mu2 minus mu1, mu2 minus mu transpose. Okay, and mu2 minus mu1 is same, but mu2 minus transpose W is nothing but m2 minus mu1. So from there, and now basically from equation 9.38, what you can do is you can replace this SBW value here. So this is what is basically you wrote SW in, so lambda W is equal to SW inverse, and SBW value is mu2 minus mu1 m2 minus mu1. So they're saying W is directly proportional to SW inverse mu2 minus mu1, and because we are only interested in the direction of W, not in the values of W, in which direction we have to project the data, we can directly do the equal to here. So this is what they're doing, and this is direction basically for in case of two classes only. Not for the multi classes. In case of multi classes, you have to solve this equation for eigenvectors, and then you for two classes you can take this direction, and for this direction basically you have to project the data and find for the processing. They have done this for like these two classes. So they have shown in case of two class classification, red is a class, blue is a class. This is the PCA result. For PCA, this is the W direction. This is the direction of W, and this is the like histogram plot of this data after the analysis basically. So you can see after the projection, lots of like the class blue dots and red dots are going to be on the like in the center basically. They are intermingled with each other, but when you do the Fisherman FLDA, then you can see if you project on this line, then the blue points and the red points are far apart from each other. They are dense and their mean are quite separated with each other. And this is the another view of this data. And the classes are far separate. So it is much better as compared to the C1. Okay. So that's why this particular FLDA is better in this case as compared to the PCA. And they also done few analysis on the higher class, like not for the two classes, but the like multiple class data. Then this is the result of the PCA. You can see the blue dots are highly distributed and red dots are highly distributed. But when it is done with the FLDA, then you can see the concentration of the blue dots, red dots, and the green and others are highly concentrated with each other. So it also performs better here in case of. So it's this. I think this is the C is equal to 11. There are 11 classes here, and they have done the dimensionality B is equal to 10. But they have projected this data to the two dimensional. So you are seeing the projected data, like projected dimension data. Okay. So this next is the, so right now that finding the dimension W that we have already discussed, whatever we discussed is for only for two class cases. And now they have extended that to the multi-class cases. And I'm not going to discuss this because just extension of this. So you just need to compute now SW, SB, and all things will come to the matrix form. And you need to just like, again, maximize the J capital W here. And in this J capital W, and you basically just find this W to be SW inverse U, where you are the K leading eigenvector of this particular matrix. So this is just the extension of this. Okay. So here comes the discussion over the FLDA basically, and the next topic is knight-based classifier. So till now we have discussed detail about, we are only learning the class conditional distribution here because this is what LDA is all about. You are going for the generative models, and the generative, you have a class prior distribution of the class. That is right now we have basically assumed it to be either the categorical or basically the uniform. And the major learning is basically in the px given by equal to c theta. Okay. And we were taking as a Gaussian distribution till now. Gaussian distribution, and we just relax the sigma c to the whole sigma, like covariance matrix, so that the boundary will become linear. Now, in the knight-based classifier, which have a very strong assumptions that the features are independent of each other. So in the knight-based classifier, because features are independent of each other, then what we can do is px given yct, if the x has d features, and then we can simply do the multiplication d is equal to 1 to d pxt given y is equal to c xdc. So in this case, basically, now while learning this, you can make these kind of assumptions here. And the equation basically will simply convert to P by given C, and pi d is equal to like this yc is a, it becomes a prior of the class, and then the posterior like the class conditional distribution is basically now d is equal for each end class xd. So basically now the distribution learning of P become easier, because now you do not have to learn that multivariate like kind of distribution for each and every class. You can simply learn a separate distribution of each and each different dimension d, so, and then can multiply with each other. So this is just the only change that you have to do in case of Nyquist classes. Okay. So the example models is saying is, what are the example models you can use? Like I have defined what is the P, like in this P xd given y is equal to c xdc. What are the distribution, different distribution you can use here? That depends on what is the what is the data you have in that particular feature d1 d2 d3 till d. So let's suppose x1 is a kind of a gender which consists of male or female. Then in that case, its value is either you can take as 0 or 1, and then in that case you can basically learn a Bernoulli distribution here for that particular feature d. And if that particular feature has some 1 2 3 4 5 6 like the categorical data, then you can learn some categorical distribution over that. And if has some real data, then you can learn like some Gaussian distribution for that feature, and then you can multiply the probability because those are independent of each other. So this is the same thing they have defined. In case of categorical features, you can learn categorical distribution. In case of real value feature, you can learn a Gaussian distribution, but this Gaussian distribution is going to be univariate because it's just an XD. So for single dimension, you are computing that. So you just need to learn a single dimension univariate Gaussian distribution. Okay. So this is how basically you can learn a Nyquist classifier for any given data. So now we know that, okay, if our model is like, we have a certain more assumptions on our class conditional distribution, if the features are independent, then we can learn something like this also. Now the next topic is model fitting. So now we are going to say how we can basically whatever Nyquist classifier we have learned. So I told you that we can learn categorical distribution, we can learn real value distribution, we can learn this, but how we are going to learn it? We can use MLE for that, maximum likelihood estimation for that. So the overall, if you can, like if you go with the likelihood equation of this particular thing, then n is equal to 1 to n for all data points. Take the categorical distribution yn given pi, and for each individual feature, the probability of xnd given yn and theta d. Okay, and then you can basically multiply over different classes also, c is equal to 1 to c, like because you have to learn that for different classes. Okay. And the equation is basically converted to this. This is same equation that we have seen in the past. The only change is now we have seen that this part increases, like d is equal to 1 to d and capital D, because now the features are independent of each other. And this is like same equation as the older one. So we can learn them differently, like this part differently, this part differently. So this is what they're saying, that you can learn this differently, you can learn this differently. And the first one, you can learn the same way, like we learned like categorical, like multivariate categorical distribution. And this part also, you can learn like down log P, but with respect to the D, different P you can learn here. Okay. So this is what they're saying here. You can learn something like this. And even in case of discrete features, you can use a categorical distribution. So, but this is going to be now with respect to each class and each feature. And K is the distinct value they are taking, because they are assuming the categorical distribution. And for if a feature, let's suppose a feature D is taking K different value and that belongs to a class C, then you can basically run theta DCK and DCK by NC. It's a MLE of the any categorical distribution, which K is value, which any variable can take value 1 to K. Okay. If you are assuming that particular feature has a binary, like it has a binary feature, then you can also learn NDCM. And if it has a real value, same as you can learn a Gaussian distribution. Okay. So this is how like you can also learn a Nyquist classifier using MLE approach. So the next point is now there's we have just discussed how we can learn the knife based classifier using our MLE estimation approach. So but here now how we are going to compute the like the posterior distribution basically. So we have learned till now only this P like class distribution Px given y equal to c class conditional distribution. Okay. So one other way you can basically compute the prior is basically using the Dirichlet distribution. Okay. So so there are certain concept of called conjugate distribution, and for like beta Bernoulli, like for beta distribution the Bernoulli, the beta is the prior, for Gaussian the Gaussian is the prior, for Dirichlet is the prior distribution. I think that makes the math easier. That's why these kind of things are defined, and you can find the posterior distribution in the closed form in this case. So right now how we are computing the posterior distribution is basically we take the prior distribution, we compute the prior distribution, and then we learn a class conditional distribution, and then we multiply the probability, and that's how we are computing the posterior distribution. But in certain cases you can also find the closed form solution of a posterior distribution, which is basically p theta given d. And in this case, in order to find the closed form solution, what you can do is you have to choose the distribution of the prior and the class conditional distribution to be the conjugate of each other. So Dirichlets are conjugates of each other, and beta Bernoulli, Gaussian, these are just conjugates of each other. If you go via this approach, then you can also find the closed form solution of the posterior. So this is just the set, like they only like write the equation for the Dirichlet prior. But I think this thing can be extended to the Gaussian or the beta Bernoulli and all other things. So this is only that, and rest of the part is I think is just defining the multiple, like using the distribution and just defining the parameter. Now the next part is basically the connection between the naive Bayes and the logistic regression. So I'm little not sure, like logistic regression the next chapter, and they are like, is the logistic regression has been discussed before? I'm not sure. So logistic regression is simple, like you basically have, you have given p y given x, and you are directly learning p y given x, and the equation is basically 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus w transpose, like w transpose x plus b, and you are learning w here there in the logistic regression. And that you basically also do by maximizing the likelihood, likelihood of this particular thing. Okay, and that comes with the, because the logistic regression defined for binary classification, then there y equal to 0 or 1. So you take the probability as a basically as a Bernoulli distribution, and then you compute the MLE, and you can go ahead with the gradient approach to minimize the like negative log likelihood. So this is how logistic regression generally works. And but here basically we are saying how it is, what the connection between naive Bayes, like naive Bayes means here we are assuming that the features are independent of each other. The logistic regression, like do we assume that the feature are independent of each other or not? That like ideally yes, yeah. It also assumes that the features are independent. So here basically this is basically the class conditional distribution. We already have written something like that before, like for each d equal to 1d, and they are defining this only for categorical distribution, but it is in general true for any exponential family distribution. So exponential family distribution has a certain form, Gaussian, Bernoulli, and all, like uniform all are exponential family distribution that can be shown by converting them, writing them into a special form. So basically what they're saying is that now, because they are saying each and every feature is categorical, so for each feature d, they can basically write a one hot encoding of xd, and if that feature d can take k distinct value, then you can write xdk is equal to indicator of xd is equal to k. Okay, so it's a one hot encoding representation of a particular value of the feature 3, and that's why they are saying k is equal to 1 to capital K also they are taking, because they are assuming that maximum up to k values a particular d can take. So that's why they are defining this. And pi is equal to 1 to d, and theta dck is basically x d. So this is the theta which will come out, because they are assuming categorical, so it's a multi, like that is a categorical distribution where the value is from 1 to k. So this came out to be theta d theta. So this is a class conditional. So this is not a posterior. Now the posterior over the class is given by P y is equal to C given x theta. And now you are doing basically this prior distribution pi C of the class C and the same equation, whatever has been written here is this. And you have to do the summation over all possible classes. And you take log and exponential is just a conversion of like exponential log of this equation. And if this equation can easily be like written as a softmax of this, okay? Because this is a softmax equation. Like if you take the softmax, the softmax is basically e to the power x like divided by summation over all possible x e to the power. Okay, so this is a kind of softmax where you are defining beta z gamma z. And this is basically the same equation as multinomial logistic regression. So in case of sigmoid, like two class classification, we go for sigmoid, but multi-class, we use softmax, it's simple. And then this is the softmax pressure equation came out from the knife-based classifier. And this says that like they basically, exactly the same, this is the same form as the multinomial logistic regression, which they have already defined that in the section 2.5.3. So two people may have studied that. So this is the connection basically between the knife-based and logistic regression. Okay. So they basically follow the same form. Now the huge things like the last, I think is the last topic. Okay. So the difference between generative versus discriminative classifier. So the generative, I already told like generative, you are learning Px given Y and then multiplying the prior to compute the posterior. In discriminating, you are directly learning Py given X as a discriminative classifier. So there the advantage is like better predictive accuracy. I think discriminative is the classifier is more accurate than the generative classifier because the task here is just to discriminate between the two like the multiple classes. But in case of generative, you learn, you basically given a class, you learn the compute the distribution of X itself, like kind of a generation of X given the class. So this distribution is going to be more complex as compared to the distribution where you are just separating out the multiple classes. So in that sense, the discriminative classifier has the more power as compared to the generative. So, and also like can handle feature preprocessing. The thing is that, so what happen in some cases, if you are like your current features are not have much discriminative power, then what you do is you compute some other features by you transform your feature X into some other space, like you take polynomial, you do some multiple things, and then over that you can learn your discriminative classifier. But in this case, if you transform your data X or Y X into some other form like sigmoid, then the whole distribution may become more complex here. And like that pre-processed data is very, maybe defined a very hard like generative also on such pre-processed data. And well-calibrated property, like probability, like in case of some like generative classifier, like naive Bayes, they are making very strong assumptions about the data, like the features are independent and all, but these kind of things, in the discriminative models, like a simple model like logistic regression, they do a better adjustment basically with respect to that. So I think they are also have a more power, like advantage of this discriminative classifier or the generative classifier, the LD approach. But there are certain also advantage of the generative classifiers, and this is basically they are easy to fit in the sense you can take the example of knife base, all the features are independent of each other, then you can compute the, you do not have to basically learn the multivariate distribution, just univariate with respect to a feature, and then you can simply learn it. And but in case of even for logistic regression, if you go, then the error function, but whatever the maximum likelihood function is there, that will that equation is like a convex problem, and then you basically optimize that convex function for the logistic regression. And you can easily handle missing input features. So if any feature is missing in case of generative models, then what you can do in case of naive Bayes, what you can do is like you can simply in the multiplication part d is equal to d, like when you do multiplication over all possible values, then you can simply ignore that. So This is possible in case of generative feature, but I think discriminative classifier assume that all value must be present in the data. Can fit class separately. This is by default in the generative model, because for each class you fit a model. Basically the generative model P X given Y is equal to C, like given a class, you fit a generative model, but independently. And but in case of discriminative models, the all the parameters stacks with each other, and you basically that's the advantage of this is that suppose a new class will come out, like right now your class is 4, now it's 5, then in case of generative, you just need to learn the PX given Y for that new class. But in case of discriminative model, you have to retrain your model again with the full data. So that's the advantage of the generative classifier or discriminative with this. And there are a few more advantages I can go through, can handle unlabeled training data and maybe more robust to spurious features. So there are multiple advantages of generative features as compared to the discriminative model. And discriminative model has its own advantage over the generative ones. And I think this is not much. So this concludes my discussions over. This is the simple exercise that I showed. Like this is the exercise they have given to help you. You just need to differentiate with respect to W to get this equation. Yeah, and just applying the simple division rule of the differentiation. So this concludes my discussion over the linear discriminant analysis. So the few lines in the conclusion is that it's a very good tool if you are dealing with the multi-class classification problem. And under the hood, it uses Gaussian distribution to model the probability of each and every class, each and every data points in the class. And it's better than PCA for dimensional reduction. If your future task, like the further, if you are looking for further classification of the data, because it takes into picture the classes also. By the PCA doesn't do that. Yeah. If there is any questions, thanks all. And if there is any questions or anything you want to ask, you are open.
Well, thank you very much, Jayton, for a great presentation. Feel free to unmute your microphones, everybody. And if there's any questions that you have for Jayton, that would be a good time to ask them.
How can I see the chat?
If you go to the bottom of the screen, you should get a little menu that appears where you can select chat. And actually, if you stop sharing your screen, people will see the chat.
I can't see the chat.
So I have a quick question. When we were talking about the connection between logistic regression and LDA, is it fair to say that LDA is a generalization of logistic regression?
I will say no, because logistic regression is more of a discriminant approach towards the classification. So so where we are directly learning P, Y given X, theta, and here we are not learning that. We are basically learning in the generative sense, basically the probability distribution of each and every data, like data point for given a class. So these were different approaches, and why the people are trying to, so yeah, it's a good question, and why the people are trying to make a connection then between I think I'll show little of Nyquist classes. Yeah, they are making the connection between the two. I think they're doing the same. So they are making the connection between the LDA and regression. So what I'll say is, in case of logistic regression, is generally used for two-class classification, even if it can be used for multi-class, like different approaches. But when we are using that for, like, let's suppose LDA we are using for two class and logic regression we also for the sum, then they're saying that they basically are going to take the same kind of forms, like the probability distribution is going to take the same form, but you will give the different, even if it's taking the same form, but you will get the different results. So like you can look into this line, in logic we estimate W directly, in general these can give different results. So even if the forms are same, but you will get the different result using the both approaches.
Okay.
Because the techniques are different. You are where you are learning P Y given X, and here you are first learning P X given Y C and the prior distribution and multiplying it.
So it's because of, in one case we're optimizing the joint likelihood, and in the other case we're optimizing the conditional likelihood.
Yes.
I see. Okay.
I've got a question. You know, you mentioned about well-calibrated. So I'm wondering what exactly well-calibrated mean?
Where?
When you were discussing about discriminative analysis, you mentioned about well-calibrated probability in discriminative classifier. You know?
I didn't remember in which sense I have used this term. If
it's in the advantages of discriminator classifier.
Okay. Advantages of discriminator classifier. Okay, better predictive accuracy. It's a better predictive accuracy.
Last point.
Yeah, I think it's in well. Yeah, what does well calibrated mean?
Okay. So well calibrated means I'll say that the probability which we are going to compute with the discriminative classifier, we are not making any assumptions there. In case of when we are computing the probabilities in case of generative ones, that in the naive ways we are assuming that there's the independence assumptions and also we are assuming that for a given P X given Y, we are assuming that X is Gaussian distributed, like we are taking as a Gaussian distribution. Maybe not be possible that those data points are not Gaussian distributed, maybe some other distribution is there. So in that sense, the probability with and in the discriminative case, we are directly learning P Y given X. And there we are not making any assumption about the distribution of the data points X. So in that sense, I think the probability which we compute with the discriminative models are well calibrated, while in case of generative, there are certain assumptions in between when we compute the probability.
So if the probability value is very close to one or very close to zero, that means it's well calibrated.
You're saying if it is close to zero or is close to one, it is well calibrated.
No, I'm asking. I'm just trying to clear it.
I think it's actually the opposite. I think that if posterior class probabilities are near zero or one, then it's not well calibrated.
Yes, you're right. Yeah.
But why? Because we wanted close to those values, right?
I mean, if I understand his paragraph on well-calibrated probabilities, he's saying that one of the advantages of the discriminative classifiers is that they don't make the strong dependence assumptions because they're often not valid. And that's what results in extreme posterior class probabilities near zero or one. So he's saying that the discriminative models are more calibrated in terms of their probability estimates, I guess.
Yes.
Right, okay. So if it's not very close to zero and one, it means it's well calibrated.
Yes, I think that's correct.
Okay.
I think the well-calibrated has nothing to do with the 0 and 1. It's all about how you're computing this probability. So like in case of even discriminative, some values, like if the model is very sure that this data point belongs to the class 0 or class 1, then it will give like probability very close to 1 for that particular thing also. So I think well-calibrated means that how well it is getting computed given the data. Because in case of generative models, you are making a lots of assumptions on the data, then that's how we are saying that, okay, because of certain assumptions that these probabilities maybe are going in a very extreme, like extreme posterior, we are getting near 0-1. But in case of discriminative, you are not making those assumptions in your model. So that particular thing will not go towards 0 and 1. It will be as per the correct, like where it should go. So this is what I understand from Sakha.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. Okay, are there any other questions? No? Okay, well, Jayden, thank you very much for presenting. And
thanks a lot.
We're gonna, I guess we'll wrap up for today, and we'll see everybody back next week for, one thing I wanna mention is that the person presenting logistic and linear regression asked if he could present them in the reverse order, which I kind of understand because most textbooks tend to cover linear regression first and then logistic regression. So we're actually going to be doing chapter 11 first and then chapter 10. And I'm just catering to the requests of the person presenting. So
even I thought when I was presenting this that the order should be something like linear regression, logistic, and then linear discriminant analysis.
Yeah.
So that's how it makes more sense, actually.
Yeah, no, I agree that one of the biggest problems I have or criticisms I have of the book is that he tends to talk about things that he hasn't covered yet. You know, so there's a lot of forward referencing in the book, and it's a little hard to understand the points he's making because he hasn't covered that stuff yet. You know, in a way, it's good that he's making the connection, but even here, even in the well-calibrated probability is just above can handle feature preprocessing. He says C-section 20.5. I mean, that's much, much later in the book. But I don't know. I think at the end of the reading group, I'm going to ask the people who have presented and attended to make a list of things that they liked about the book and things that they thought maybe could improve. It probably won't help in the first printing because I believe it's being published in February of 2022, next month. And the reading group actually goes till I think the first week of April. But I think it would be useful to give feedback to the author.
Sure, yeah, makes sense, thanks.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you again, Jayden, and thank you again, everybody, for attending. And we'll see you next week. So have a good day or a good night, everybody.
Yeah, good night. Good night.
Okay, bye-bye.